Assalamualaikum everyone. Hope you all are doing well. This is Rasil Sami Khan from ACCI Karachi office. Thank you all for joining us for today's webinar. This is the first webinar that our very own YLP, which is the Young Leaders Program, Falak is conducting on behalf of ACCI, TDC, Pakistan, and IT Minds, where he works. So hope you all can enjoy this webinar, and I hope you all learn from this as well. Just a brief introduction of about him. He's been working with IT Minds for the past 2-3 years now, and he has quite a lot of experience in IT Minds and as well as CDC Pakistan as well. So I hope you all can hear us as well. If you can't, please do share it with us on the questions or chat box, so that we can try and fix it for you. In the meanwhile, if you have any questions or suggestions, please feel free to drop us a question on our chat box so that we can answer your queries. Falak is he has a fracture on his hand as well today, but he's still here for delivering this webinar for all of you. So please do appreciate him, and do take our time and try and interact with him for any further information that you require for CDC or for otherwise as well, because we've been engaging a lot with our YLP affiliates in the past 1 year, and this is the first time that our in Pakistan that our YLP is conducting this webinar for all of you. So I'll be handing it over to Falak, and he'll be carrying forward the whole discussion about the CDC and about the industry as well in Pakistan, which is mainly done by CDC in Pakistan, because they're the only company in Pakistan which are into this business line. So I'll be taking this, giving the stage to Falak now, and he'll be carrying forward the whole discussion. So Falak, please continue and share with us your insights on this.
Thank you for the introduction, Vasil. Hi everyone. It's a great pleasure and honor to be here. This being my first webinar being conducted for ACCA. One thing which I would like to further add to what Vasil just said, I was with the IT Minds for the past 2.5 years, but recently I've been transferred over to the operations department of the Central Depository, and now I'm responsible for the assets under custody regime in the CDC, and sorry for sporting the cast on my arm, but I was involved in an unfortunate accident. Anyway, so in today's webinar, I just want to give you a flavor of the CDC is and what it does, and the main areas which we will be covering in the webinar is the capital markets ecosystem that exists in Pakistan, the National Clearing Company of Pakistan, which is another important financial institution, the legal and regulatory framework within which Pakistan the CDC has to operate, the investor protection measures we have in place, and of course the crème de la crème, the central depository system. Other than that, we'll also be covering a few business diversifications which have taken place over the years with the CDC. So let us begin. So basically here you can see a snapshot of the capital market ecosystem which exists in Pakistan. Basically you have the SECP, which is the apex regulator, and subordinate to this regulatory body you have of course the PSX, the Pakistan Stock Exchange, the National Clearing Company of Pakistan, and the Central Depository Company of Pakistan. So basically what's going on is the PSX is the market maker where basically the trades are taking place. This is the place where buyers and sellers of shares and securities come together, and they trade shares at various prices, which then goes on to determine the stock exchange market index, and then those trades are, you know, taken by the National Clearing Company of Pakistan for settlement purposes, and then finally those trades move to the Central Depository Company, which is the ultimate custodian, the final custodian of those securities in the Central Depository System. So the capital market intermediaries basically consists of, you know, almost 240 brokers. We have 21 AMCs currently working with the assets under management of almost US dollars 6 billion. And the investors in the capital markets are composed of a mixture of, you know, retail, mutual funds, and domestic and foreign institutional investors. So that's basically one picture which can best describe the Pakistan capital market ecosystem as it exists today. So the question basically arises, what was the need for developing such infrastructure? What is the need for the National Clearing Company? What is the need for the Central Depository Company? Why not just have the Pakistan Stock Exchange? So basically what was seen over the years was, you know, the volume of trades and transactions which were taking place in the PSX was increasing exponentially. And today, as we see, you know, there are billions of shares being traded on a weekly or monthly basis. Of course, if we're talking about physical securities, you cannot, the logistical risks associated with such high volumes is just too great. You can't manage the entire system if you're, you know, carrying out those transactions using physical securities. And of course, you needed to mitigate the risks which were present with physical security, of say a threat of being, you know, of threat of theft, fraud, and you know, the destruction, the physical destruction of those securities. So in order to mitigate those risks, you know, it was seen that it's best to create an infrastructure body, create a whole infrastructure, PSX, NCCP, and CDC, to, you know, all these transactions in a purely electronic form. So in 1997, basically, after the passing of the Central Depositories Act, the Central Depository Company of Pakistan was born. And in 1997, we started our operations. The CDC is the primary infrastructure institution in Pakistan, and we have a whole range of, you know, innovative offerings. The basic and the most important, of course, being the Central Depository System itself, which manages all the physical securities in the book entry or electronic form. Then we have a whole range of investor protection measures, which are have been set up to protect the securities and safeguard the securities of the investors in the CDS. And then, of course, we have our business diversifications which have taken place over the years. And we will be going through each of these points one by one. One of the main capital market development initiatives which the Central Depository took part in was the development of the NCCPL and its operating system, the National Clearing System. NCSS is, of course, also closely integrated with the CDS, the Central Depository System. And we'll be covering, we'll be looking at this in more detail later on. So the... So basically, the CDC was, selected to create this new infrastructure body, which was, later on, it became the National Clearing Company of Pakistan Limited. And there was initially in its initial development stages, the NCCPL was a part of the CDC, but once, of course, the operations matured and it was seen that, you know, it was better to hand over these operations to a separate entity, which became the NCCPL, a National Clearing Company of Pakistan. The National Clearing Company of Pakistan, of course, operates the NCSS, which is the National Clearing and Securities System, National Clearing and Settlement System, which communicates to the CDS, the Central Depository System, the movement in shares. Basically, what that means is, you know, who owes what to whom, and it also communicates to the settling bank the movement of funds. Basically, who in terms of cash. So since its very founding, the strategic focus of CDC has been on these three main areas. Basically, it's there to we are there to facilitate investors. You know, we are there to outreach of the capital market and enhance the accessibility of your everyday investor to those financial services. And perhaps most importantly, we have to maintain a secure information system. Since, of course, you might know that the central depository system is a complete IT infrastructure, and the security and integrity of that system is of the foremost concern of the central depository company. In no way can that system ever be compromised, and we have lots and lots of procedures and contingencies in place to ensure that that never happens, no sort of material breach ever takes place. So what is the legal and regulatory framework within which the company operates? All our policies, practices, and standard operating procedures are derived from and designed to satisfy the requirements of these laws and regulations. The most recent piece of legislation in this is, of course, the Companies Act 2017, which has replaced and which has repealed and replaced the Companies Ordinance 1984. And we'll be going through each of these in turn now. So basically, the creation of the Central Depository Company was done through the CD Act, the Central Depositories Act of 1997, and contains all the rules and policies for the operations of the Central Depository System. As you can see, the main features are for opening and maintenance of accounts and sub-accounts. Here we also have to validate the deposits and withdrawals and transfer and pledges of securities. We also have to deal with the eligibility of securities in terms of who is eligible to bring their securities into the CDS. So they have a whole list of requirements which they have to fulfill from the legal and regulatory standpoint, and then we have to review in order to confirm, okay, these are the securities which are found fit for purpose for inducting into the Central Depository Company. And of course, we have the handling of corporate actions. Corporate actions basically mean the disbursement of dividends, e-dividends, and your bonus shares and your right issues. And then finally, of course, the settlement of securities. As I just said in the beginning of the webinar, we have your PSX where the trade's taking place, the NCCPL where the trades are being settled, and then finally, of course, those settled transactions. CDS. We'll be talking about this in greater detail in the next few slides. Another piece of the CDC has to comply with is, of course, the Central Depositories Licensing and Operations Regulations 2016. And the regulation covers all the criteria which are required to be met by any CDS, any CSD, basically any central depository company, the registration and renewal requirements, and the corporate governance structure which has to meet, and of course the financial resources and the shareholding requirements which it has to meet. And then of course we have the CDC regulations themselves. Basically, many of you might not know this, but CDC itself is to ensure the CDC regulations are enforced against all the participants in the market, and for that, of course, we have our own compliance and compliance department and internal audit department, which looks after all of these things. So basically, you have these regulations covering the opening and maintenance of accounts and sub accounts in the CDS, the criteria of recognition of persons as account holders. Similarly, you have enforcement actions and disciplinary proceedings against any of the participants if required, and so on and so forth. And of course, one of the main points which I have to highlight is, of course, the handling of book entry security. What exactly do I mean by book entry security? Book entry security is basically, it's another way of saying an electronic security. Coming now to the corporate governance structure at CDC. Of course, since the CDC is a public unlisted company, it complies with the code of corporate governance on a voluntary basis. And as many of you will know from your P1 studies, what the requirements of the code are, and basically CDC has to follow them all. So you have your the requirements for the composition of the board, where you have 10 non-executive directors and your chief executive officer, and then you have your composition of the committees of the board, which I'm sure all of you must be familiar with. And then of course you have the corporate and financial reporting frameworks and their procedures as well. But of course the requirements of the court, you have your chief internal auditor, and you also have your internal audit function, which is separate operationally from your departments. And of course, as it's written over here, also the chief internal auditor, he reports operationally to the audit committee rather than to the board of directors or to the CEO or chief operating officer. Acha. With the promulgation of course, the Central Depositories Licensing and Operations Regulation, the compliance and risk function of CDC was further strengthened by the appointment of a chief compliance and risk officer. Before these regulations, this compliance and risk function was part of the internal audit department. But since the promulgation of these regulations, of course, this has become a separate function within the CDC, which is solely responsible for maintaining compliance and risk management of the CDC. The CCRO, of course, reports operationally to the board of directors. And one of the things which are interesting is the appointment and removal of the chief executive officer and the chief internal officer, internal auditor, and chief financial officer, and so on and so forth. It's not just the board's decision, but also the SECP has a say in this as well. So, when it comes to audits, of course, we have one of the biggest audits of CDC is, of course, a system audit, not just in terms of systems, but also in terms of our IT systems, because the central depository system is basically an IT infrastructure, right? All the securities are being maintained in electronic form, and therefore the integrity and security of that system is the foremost concern for the central depository company, and therefore there is a separate audit which is conducted for that system, and again it's conducted by external auditors who specialize in that area. And then of course we have the regulatory auditors, the audit of the compliance with the regulations and laws as it's applicable on the CDC. We just saw which ones those were. And then, of course, you have the review of the Code of Corporate Governance by the external auditors. And then, of course, we come to the Central Depository System, which is the name is pretty self-explanatory, but simply put, it is a depository system for the secure parking of securities in electronic form. If I can use an analogy over here, think of a bank where you park your cash in a bank account. The concept is basically similar, but instead of parking your securities in the central depository system. And that's basically what the central depository system is. So the central depository system is basically an electronic book entry system that records, tracks, and maintains ownership and transfers of securities. So book entry is basically a paperless system tracking the ownership and transfer of securities, whereby investors do not receive any physical securities for their securities, but those securities are there in their accounts in electronic form. And of course, you have these the system is applicable, you know, on not just shares, but also on debt and other financial instruments as well, such as, you know, TFCs and Sukuk certificates, reference shares, you have your commercial papers as well. And the key business functions, you know, which are facilitated by the CDS, again, because of the high volume of transactions which are taking place, the CDS has a very central role in, you know, each of these business functions where, you know, investors want to deposit or transfer their securities, or, you know, they want to pledge their securities in the CDS, or although this rarely happens, there are a few who would want to, you know, withdraw their securities from the CDS, and basically, you know, that's they're taking their securities in electronic form and they're transferring it over to a physical form. And then, of course, you have your corporate actions as well, whether it's the disbursement of dividends or bonus shares or right share, that too, of course, takes place through the CDS. So this is basically, you know, the list of which can be, you know, done through the CDS. Of course, the primary role of the CDS is, you know, the safekeeping of securities. And through the NCCPL, of course, we also see the settlement of transactions. And, you know, you've got your transfer of securities, your deposit of physical securities, withdrawal, as we just discussed, and pledging of securities. One of the questions which I would, you know, like to ask the audience is, can anyone tell me what's the meaning of, you know, pledging a security? What's a pledge of securities? So if, you know, anyone has an answer to that, you know, they can answer in the conversation box and, you know, we can have a discussion on that as well. Other than that, of course, you have your, yeah, the direct credit of securities against an IPO. We also have electronic IPO system in the CDS. Basically, an IPO takes place and we directly credit those securities against the respective account holders in the CDS. So you have your credit of bonus shares, your credit of shares against IPOs and right issues, and of course your provision of data to the issuers for dispatch of dividends and for correspondence. Then you also have your, within the CDS, of course, if say two issuers, they merge or split or consolidate, then those shares are also merged or split or consolidated within the CDS on that basis. So talking about the integration of both these systems, basically the central depository system and the national clearing and settlement system, are very, very closely integrated with each other. They're basically glove in hand. Because as I told you in the beginning, okay, the transaction starts from the PSX, gets settled in the NCSS, and then finally is reflected in the security balances in the CDS. Of course, the CDS accounts are linked with the unique identification number, which is assigned by the NCSS, and that's basically how we identify, okay, which transaction has to fall within which CDS account. That's basically our primary identification number. And of course, you have all your movement of securities taking place all the way from, you know, X, your NCSS all the way to your CDS. And of course, in order for this to take place, you have all the legal and regulatory and, you know, the necessary agreements in place in order to ensure that, you know, everything is well integrated and everything runs as smoothly as possible. Coming now to the investor protection measures. We have a whole range of, you know, product lines which are there for the facilitation and the protection of investors. Mainly, you know, you have your SMS and e-alerts and your web access, and you also have, you know, your e-statements of sub-accounts and investor account holders. And recently we also launched, you know, the direct settlement services for our investors, and of course asset under custody regime, which is being operated by the operations department of the CDS, and of which I am currently a part. And finally, of course, we also conduct, you know, periodic awareness sessions for investors, the provincial capitals, but also the outlier cities of Pakistan, especially in the Punjab, where you have these main population centers such as Sialkot or Faisalabad. So we regularly try to conduct as many investor awareness sessions as possible in all of these cities. Talking about the direct settlement services, basically what it entails is that the investor's cash and securities both are held by the CDC, which basically allows for the direct settlement of trades. So the only role which is left for the broker to do is to execute on the transaction. He is neither in custody of the security, nor is he in custody of cash. So how this basically investors is, for example, the broker defaults and has to, goes bankrupt. Neither the cash nor the security of the investor is at risk, because he's got all of his securities and all of his cash part in one investor account. And that is the only account he has to operate. He doesn't have to, with any broker. So which is an additional facility for them. But of course, the main advantage over here is the security and cash as well. Secondly, we have the assets. This is basically primarily my responsibility in the CDS, where I am involved in the valuation of the net worth of participants, analyze financial statements of participants, make any adjustments deemed necessary, and then arrive at their net worth valuation. So basically, focuses on any potential undervaluing of liabilities, overvaluing of assets, underreporting of expenses, or overreporting of revenues. Basically, our focus is on anything that which can window dress the financial position of the participant. Why is this necessary? Because we want them to maintain a minimum net worth in case they default. At least we will be able to recover the monies from their assets in case they default. So this is of course one of the main risk management and measures that are there in the CDC. So as I said, the investment the investor awareness sessions, they take place all over Pakistan, and we try to ensure to cover as many main population centers of Pakistan, not just in the main provincial cities, Karachi or Lahore or Peshawar, but main population centers of Pakistan, other than these provincial capitals as well. So basically, we are making them aware not only of the financial services or the services which are being provided by the central depository company, but also the financial services which are being provided by the mutual fund industry, how they can participate in the capital markets, how they can invest, how can this it's not just the services which are being covered by the CDC, but also by other financial institutions in the market as well. So it's not just investor, also investor education. Now, the business diversifications which have taken place in the central depository company, some of you might know the trustee and custodial services which are being offered by CDC, we have an almost a monopoly in Pakistan, since we are offering trustee services to almost 95% of the mutual funds in Pakistan. The service was basically started when this was identified as a gap in the market, where mutual funds were looking for a trusted institution whom they could give the trusteeship of the mutual fund assets. We are also offering share registrar services, whereby alhamdulillah today CDC is not CDC is the largest Notarial Registrar service provider in Pakistan. And of course, it's backed up by a very strong technology arm as well, where we are able to manage a high volume and many clients basically allowed us to dominate the market here as well. IT Minds Limited, of course, is where I used to work formerly, as Vasil covered in his introduction. IT Minds is a BPO, a business process outsourcing services. It's primarily engaged in providing BPO services to the mutual fund industry. And services, of course, which it offers include, you know, fund accounting, settlement services, and unit management services, which basically, you know, includes the sale and redemption of mutual fund units. Of course, the team which is working for IT Minds is backed up by the back office accounting system, which they use services, and we have almost, you know, I think GCA is working for IT Minds, which is a pretty good number, alhamdulillah. So basically, you have these statistics in front of you, and these statistics basically show, you know, the really exemplary growth that CDC has experienced over the years, and has really helped it make it one of the premier financial institutions in Pakistan. So of course, even with these high flying numbers, our work isn't really finished yet, because you know, we are aiming to further expand the outreach of the capital market. And enhance the accessibility of investors from all corners of the country. Of course, our work is all the more important given that the rate of financial services penetration, I'm sure Russell can add a lot to this as well, the rate of financial services penetration in Pakistan is considerably lower than, you know, our peers in the South Asian region. So, of course, we have a lot of work to do. Even though these numbers may seem really impressive, I can assure you that we have a lot more work to do, and we are right on the case. Of course, coming now to the accreditations which CDC has. CDC is a highly accredited organization. These are some of the accreditations which are in front of you, you know, which is befitting, of course, for an institution whose you know, systems and operational and IT infrastructure is extremely critical for the smooth functioning of Pakistan's capital markets. We especially have to really focus on the IT systems which are in place, their security and their integrity, because we simply cannot face the risk of any breach or any compromise of those systems because of, you know, the knock-on effect which will be incurred on the other financial institutions which are there in the market, and then, of course, the Pakistan capital market as a whole. So that was basically, you know, a flavor of what the CDC is. So with that, I would like to, you know, thank you, and I'll questions which you might have, and over to you, Vasil.
Yeah, there were a couple of questions, Falak. One of them was by Ajay. What are the tech features covered and offered by CDC?
Well, one of as I, you know, mentioned in the investor protection measures which we have in place. We have, in fact, if we can go back to that particular slide, you know, we have all the standard web, all these standard, you know, protection measures which are there for any bank account holder as well. For example, right, such as SMS and web access and e-alerts and all that. But other than that, the main feature which I would say is there in place is, you know, the direct settlement services. Currently, where your securities and your cash are being held under one account, so you don't have to maintain any sub account with any broker. All your cash and all your securities are in you know, the custody of the central depository system in a safe and secure environment. So even if, God forbid, the broker defaults and goes bankrupt, nothing's going to happen to your cash.
Another question by Fahad was how CDC is linked with security companies, and please give the basic concept of CDC and how risk management falls into CDC. For instance, MTS and so on. Where is CDC playing that role specifically?
Well, basically, as I said in the beginning, the basic concept of CDC is if I can compare it to a bank where you go to a bank, you open an account over there, and you deposit your cash. CDC is the place where you go and open your account in order to deposit your securities in electronic form. You may have them in physical form, but it's obviously better to keep them in a safe and secure location. So that's the basic function of the central depository system. The whole CDC concept is based on that concept.
And
The
how does
risk
this
management
system
features, of
work?
course, which we already covered, were, of course, again, the direct settlement services which are being provided are there to, secure your assets. You don't have to depend on any broker to maintain custody of your cash or your securities. All you have to do is, open an investor account and keep your securities, and yeah, this one, direct settlement. You have to keep your cash and securities with your investment account, and if he defaults or runs away, then there is no risk on you that you'll lose securities. And of course, we also assets under custody regime, which is another risk management measure we have in place, where we require the participant to maintain a minimum net worth, so that if he defaults, then we will be able to recover monies from the assets and use those monies to compensate the investors.
He was also asking regarding MTS, MFS, MTS, MFS, and so on. Where is CDC playing that role specifically?
When we do have margin trading and margin finance, sorry, what is the question?
It's
Oh,
fine.
sorry, okay. So basically, what's happening is you have the account holders opening accounts. Basically, you have the participants opening account holder accounts with the CDC, and of course, MTS and MFS are transactions which are being these by the PSX, and of course, those transactions are also reflected in the NCCPL. And of course, whatever transactions take place, they are eventually reflected in the central depository company.
What is the difference between a sub-account and the account we open in a security company like BPA, BMA, real securities that usually give two different account numbers?
Basically, your account holder account is the account which your broker is opening with the CDC, and your sub account is basically the account which you have to open under that account. So basically, you're opening your account with the broker, and then you have your sub account under that broker's account. So again, the custody of those securities is, of course, with the one of the risks with the sub account system. If your broker, he defaults and goes bankrupt, then there's a risk that those securities will be lost, and of course you'll have to bear the loss for that as well.
Okay, I'm Joe. So that a question. I'm doing a job outside the benefit from CDC.
Well, what's the name? Bilal.
Bilal.
Bilal, what I can tell you is we do have all the facilities which are available for domestic retail investors are also available for overseas Pakistanis. So you can open your accounts with the CDC, and you can operate them just the way other domestic Pakistanis can. And there will be, I think, a few documentary requirements which will be different for you. But other than that, of course, you will be able to operate them online just as you would be able to if you were living here.
Okay, These were the few questions. I have one more question for you.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea of how many ADCs are working in CDC and IT nodes at the moment?
We have around two dozen, almost 24 or 25 ACCs, the exact number. The bulk of the ACCs are working in our trustee department, since basically the trustee department has to safeguard all the assets of the mutual funds which are operating in Pakistan, and they have to monitor the compliance. There's a financial reporting factor as well, cash flows, settlements, bank reconciliations. So the skill set which ACCs have to offer are most applicable in that environment, in that department. And by far, of course, the single biggest player for ACCs in central in CDC is our trustee department. We have three ACCs working in our internal audit department, looking after the internal audit at different levels. And ACCs are also working in our risk management and compliance department. And me, I'm working in the operations department, looking after the assets under custody regime, as we just discussed during the webinar. And of course, as we asked specifically about IT Minds, we have around 5 to 6 ACCs, students, affiliates, and members working for IT Minds, and primarily in the fund accounting department, in the finance department, which has been outsourced by the CDC to IT Minds.
Okay, any other questions, participants? If you have, please do share it with us. Otherwise, then we'll be closing the session because I'm not sitting at the moment. Any more questions?
Guys, if you have any more questions, I'll be happy to
Yeah.
Answer them.
Okay, I'll ask you a question in the meanwhile. What is the process for applying for ACC affiliates and finance at CDC?
Well, the easiest way for that would be, of course, go to the website and go to the job section and just drop your CV over there. What I've seen other people do as well, they come over to CDC and bring a CV in hand and, they hand it over to our reception and, with a covering letter, and they ask for that CV to be sent, to the HR department. But if any of you are interested in working for the CDC, I'll put out my contact details through Asil, and you can get in touch with me, and then you can work out something from there as well.
Okay. Any other questions, audience? What is the difference between CDC and NCCPL?
Can you go to the second slide?
Yeah.
If you guys just have a look, another look at the second slide of the webinar. So basically, looking at the screenshot of the capital markets, what's happening is the Pakistan Stock Exchange is the market maker. That's where the buyers are meeting the sellers, and that's where the buying and selling prices of shares are being decided. Trades take place, those transactions are then moved over to the National Clearing Company. The National Clearing Company basically looks at all of those trades, and then it decides who to whom in terms of securities and in terms of cash. In terms of securities, that information is then communicated over to the CDC, which says, move this many securities from this account to this account. And then you have another communication taking place with the settlement bank by the NCCPL, which tells the bank to move this much cash from this much cash, or this much cash is owed by this person to this person. So the NCCPL is basically where the transaction is settled. So the PSX is where the transaction is taking place. NCCPL is where the transaction is settled. And then finally, whatever balances are there are finally reflected in the CDC's central repository system.
Can you share a few features as well? Fahad is asking.
One of the main features, again, of course, similar like the, you know, the central repository, the NCCPL and its operation running on the NCSS, which is the National Clearing and Settlement System. Both this National Clearing Settlements and Settlement System, NCSS and CDS, right, which are tightly indicated because they have to communicate with each other on a daily basis, where the NCCPL tells tells the CDS what is the balance order of each transaction against each account, and you know, on that basis the CDS then moves those securities, whatever the quantity holder, into their respective accounts.
Hope we've answered your questions. If you have any other more, please do share it with us. Otherwise, we'll be closing the session. Fahad has another question. Means we paid the amount to buy shares, that amount look after by NCCPL, right? And CDC looks after our balance and tells us about credit and debit to buy further shares. Can you explain? Please explain your question further again, Fahad. We couldn't understand your questions. The core tasks of NCCPL and CDC.
Well, as I said before, the NCCPL is communicates on two levels, one with the CDS and two with the settlement bank. It tells the CDS who owes what to whom in terms of shares. Tells the CDS to move those shares, and then it tells the settlement bank who owes what to whom. Okay, so if I'm trading on the PSX, then obviously I'm either buying or selling shares. So how much shares do I owe the counterparty, or how much money do I owe the counterparty? That's basically what the NCCPL tells the settlement bank and the CDS. That's basically, you know, the core task of the NCCPL, and of course then for the CDC, it is to, you know, reflect those transactions at the end of the day in the account, in the account.
I hope we've answered your question, Fahad. What is ready market and future market?
Well, ready market is basically, you know, your ready market is basically your regular market in which your trades are taking place, and of course, future market is where your future contracts are being traded. I hope you know the difference between, you know, ready shares and, you know, the future future contracts.
Maybe if you can explain that.
If I can, you know, should I delve into that? Okay. So future markets are basically, you know, future contract is basically where I have the difference between, you know, the spot and future rate. If I can give you an example between, say, currency. I have the spot rate, which is the current existing rate, but, you know, my receivable or my payable is not going to materialize until 3 months from now. So what I'm going to do through a future contract is I'm going to fix that rate, buy or sell rate for that currency 3 months from today, and I'll, you know, say to the bank, okay, this is the rate at which I'm ready to buy this much currency from you, or this is the rate at which I'm going to sell this much currency from you. So basically, it's a way of, you know, hedging my risk against you know, negative movements in the currency. The same principle, of course, applies with the shares, where, you know, I can set the future price for shares if I want to hedge my risks against, you know, an adverse movement in share prices. So that's basically, you know, the difference.
Any other questions? If you bought shares in our forward future votes, how I hedge securities?
Can you clarify a question? If you've already bought them, then how would you?
Yeah, Fahad, can you explain it again? Example of future in shares, I mean. He's asking regarding shares, I mean, instead of.
Okay, so if you, for example, if you have 100 shares of XYZ company and you want to sell those shares at price of, say, 100 rupees 3 months from now, you can enter, you know, a future contract and, you know, set that price with a counterparty and agree with that counterparty on what price you're going to sell them at. So by doing that, of course, you are hedging yourself against, you know, a decline in share prices. Of course, the flip side of that coin would be if the share price were to increase beyond that price, then of course a loss, because you should be able to, you know, sell those shares for a higher price in the market at the spot rate. So that is basically where you're hedging your you know, future sale of shares.
Anyone else has questions other than Fahad? Fahad has been asking a lot of questions to us, so no one else has been asking anything.
Yeah. The buy price or the sell price?
I hope we've tried to answer your questions, Fahad. I think we should give someone else a if anyone else has a question, please do share it with us. Otherwise, I think this is if anyone doesn't type any questions, we're waiting for a couple of more minutes. So if not, then we'll. For this squaring concept.
Fadi, you have to clarify your question for me, please.
Yeah. What is when the square of who is unable to maintain the margin?
Fahad, I think you'll have to ask that question of a broker.
Yes, I guess you need to ask that question to a broker instead of.
Yep. Broker specialization, yeah.
Yeah. Anyone else? No, maybe. Front running concept. All CDC falls into this. Any idea?
Well, I think I'll have to Google that one. because these questions, you know, they're more pertinent to, you know, the trades that are taking place on the PSX on a daily basis. So of course, are definitely, you know, forward these questions to a broker who specializes in these in this knowledge and this field, and you know, you'll definitely, you know, get a proper answer from them, I'm sure.
Bilal, do you have any questions? We've tried and already we've already answered your question on the chat box previously. So if you have any specific questions, do type into us. Otherwise, we. If no one has any questions, then thank you all so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Fana, for this session. We recorded this session, and this will be uploaded on our Vimeo and YouTube pages in the next week. So do check it out, and if you want, you can see the recording as well for it on Vimeo and YouTube. Channels in next week, most probably by end of next week, should be up and running on our Vimeo page and YouTube pages. So thank you all so much for attending this webinar. I hope you found this useful. Do share it with all your friends, affiliates, and finalists and students as well, because we want to encourage more and more people to attend this webinar and benefit from it, because these sessions are all for you guys. So we can have as many of these sessions as you want, so on different topics as well. So we've had quite a lot of activity on our Gear Up platform as well for Wild Peace. So we've had quite a few industry visits, quite a few webinars as well. So please do keep in touch and keep following our Facebook and Vimeo and YouTube pages for further updates, and do keep checking your emails as well, and junk emails as well for any emails, because we regularly send out these webinars to all our students and affiliates in Pakistan. So thank you all for attending, and do give your feedback to us on our GearUp email ID. It's gearup.pk@accglobal.com. And if you have any other further queries regarding ACCA, you can contact our customer services in Karachi. cs.khi@accglobal.com, and our UAN contact number, which is 111-222-2275. So okay then, take care and have a nice day. Thank you all for joining.
Bye, guys.
And see you soon.